Yes, so in this video I intend to break a record in this course. I will make this hopefully the shortest video so far, so I don't want to torture you too long with this topic. I only have two slides, so it can't be that long. So in this video we are going to take a look at the relationship between bias-variance decomposition, so the bias and variance terms, and the terms of underfitting and overfitting. Okay, with this slide it's actually three slides, but yeah, we are now looking at how is the bias-variance decomposition related to overfitting and underfitting. So recall this little figure here I've shown you earlier in this lecture. So yeah, there are two reasons why this is such a crude drawing. One reason is efficiency. It's pretty tedious to draw something like that in Keynote or PowerPoint. The second reason is that it's also indicating that this is just like a sketch approximation of something. This is not like based on real numbers. And in practice, you will never see a very smooth or perfect plot or relationship between these terms shown here. So in practice it will also be a noisy process if you do this for a real world data set. And yeah, so what we see here is the error, for example the squared error loss, plotted against the capacity of the model. And we talked about this before. Capacity is basically how well the model is capable of fitting a training set. So capacity is basically something like complexity. So the higher the capacity, the higher the capability of the model to fit the data well. Usually in many contexts, in the contexts of parametric models like regression models, like, polynomial regression and so forth, capacity also relates to the number of parameters or terms. So here what we have is the training error. And the larger the capacity of the model, the lower the training error. Because yeah, the more complex the model is, the better it will be able to fit the training data. For example, think of short decision trees and very deep decision trees. So short decision trees versus deep decision trees. Deep decision trees will be able to fit the data better, so the training error will go down. However, having a good or low training error doesn't mean it will perform well on new data, because it can happen that we fit the training data too closely, and then yeah, the error on new data, for example as measured on the test set, will actually increase. And that is measured by the generalization error. For example, the generalization error can be estimated from an independent test set. So, and the generalization error first improves somewhat if the capacity becomes larger, because if the model is too simple, a short decision tree will neither be able to fit the training set well nor perform well on new data, because it's just too simple of a model. If we make the model capacity larger, the model error will decrease also on new data. However, the larger the capacity becomes, the larger the error also will become after some inflection point. And the gap, in general, the gap between the training error and the generalization error, that is considered as the degree of overfitting. So it's by how much the model overfits. And in this region, is the overfitting is increasing, the gap is increasing, because the model fits the data too closely. It fits noise in the data, for example, and then it won't be able to generalize well to new data. Okay, so now how is that related to the concepts of bias and variance? So here I added two new more terms, the variance and bias. The variance here in red. So the larger the capacity of the model, the more complex the model. For example, as I've shown you also in the graphs, this could be a deep decision tree. And this is again a short decision tree on this end. It's exactly the same graph as on this previous slide, except now that I have also the variance and bias shown here. So if the capacity increases, the variance will increase, right? So that is what we've seen for deep decision trees. Also when we did the bias variance decomposition and compared it, for example, to a Begging classifier or a Begging model where we averaged. Averaging will reduce the variance, but here we are only talking about a single model. And you will see that the higher the capacity of the model, the more complex the model, the higher the variance. And this will then relate to the degree of overfitting. So models with high variance are more prone to overfitting, So here, if we have this inflection point again, overfitting increases when we go to the right, and the degree of overfitting is again the gap between the training error, here the black line, and the generalization error, the green line. So here this gap is the degree of overfitting, and it increases as the variance increases usually. And vice versa, the higher the variance becomes, the lower the bias will become. So a more complex model will usually have a lower bias. So here it looks maybe a little bit misleading. It looks like it goes down and then up again. But it's just a bad drawing. It should just go down or converge, basically, asymptotically. So the bias will go down while the variance goes up if the capacity increases, and vice versa. The bias will be large if we have a low capacity. And a large bias, you can see, is also then at the same end here as the high degree of underfitting. So when we go here to the left, when we make the model too simple, it will underfit the data, so it will not perform well on the training data, but it also won't perform well on the test set. So what happens is it will perform badly on both training and test set. And this has also some relationship to having a high bias. Oops. So yeah, high bias is usually correlated to underfitting, high underfitting, and high variance is correlated to overfitting. Okay, so that's it for the relationship between overfitting and underfitting to bias and variance. Yeah, so in the next video we will also take a brief look at the bias-variance decomposition of the 0-1 loss. It's more like, I would say, an optional topic. It's closer to our classification context, but it's somewhat more, I would say, less intuitive as decomposing the squared error loss. It's more like a workaround, but we will see more about that in the next video.